So yeah, this is a joint event that Shin and I discussed a while back between Digital Health Oxford and the Oxford University 3D Printing Society, and it's really great to have Professor Kenny Dalgarno here from Newcastle to talk to us about 3D bioprinting. So just a very brief little stint about Digital Health Oxford, for those of you who don't know. So it's a big community of clinicians, researchers, developers, entrepreneurs and others in Oxford. There's about 600 people in Oxford and beyond, and we come together and there's various different events such as this. There's one on serious games and health on next week in the business school, and yeah, it's fantastic. We've been talking about this for a wee while, and it's really fantastic to have this event on 3D printing. And with that, I'll leave Shin to do the introductions for Professor Dalgarno and say a little bit about the society as well.
Okay, thanks, Richie. As Richie mentioned, it's a co-organising event between Digital Health Oxford and Oxford 3D Printing Society. So for those of you who don't know, we're the first, I think, the university society on 3D printing in the UK, possibly Europe. So the things that we do as a society is mostly on events. So actually this is part of the second lecture of a series of educational events on 3D printing and additive manufacturing. So we did one on the general introduction on 3D printing. Next term we're going to have metal 3D printing and polymer 3D printing talks. The other things we do is our members will have access basically to the Oxford Hackspace using our 3D printers to work on the whatever projects they want to work on. And the other big things is in the society is we have this research project, what we call A4. It stands for anytime, anywhere, almost anything. It's the code name, we call it the Starcraft Factory Project. It's really looking, it's a predictive research project, a literature review project on what the future of design manufacturing is going to look like in 10, 15 years. Without further ado, today's speaker is Professor Kenneth Dalgarno. He is the Deputy Director of the EPSRC Center for Innovative Manufacturing in Medical Devices, and the coordinator of the EU FP7 Restoration Project. I'll make sure I get this right. So it's short for Resorbable Ceramic Biocomposites for Orthopedic and Maxillofacial Applications. He's also the Newcastle University's lead investigator for the EPSRC Center for Doctoral Training in Additive Manufacturing and 3D Printing. And for the past decade or so, his research really is focused on the traditional side of additive manufacturing, in rapid prototyping, polymer engineering, and manufacturing. But increasingly, his focus is on biomedical applications, including tissue engineering and regenerative medicine. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming
Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for the invitation, and then thank you for dinner. Just by way of start, can I just gauge how many of you know anything about 3D printing to start with? Are there any here who would like you, who would benefit from? I'm going to ask that another way. Who would benefit from a big introduction to 3D printing? Right. So there's, rather than have that proportion of the audience sit here baffled for a little while, I'll switch out of this a little bit then. It might make it a bit, make it all take a bit longer. Say later on a little bit more obvious. Yeah. 3D printing, additive manufacturing, all the rest of it, it's not been around long enough to get a single name yet. It's not been completely branded. But it first appeared when I first started doing it, it was called rapid prototyping. It's not very rapid always, but it did make prototypes. And then for reasons that will become obvious, layer manufacturing, rapid manufacturing, additive layer manufacturing, full 3D modification. But the tag that's kind of stuck in the press and everywhere else is 3D printing. And to be honest, some people get very concerned about what's 3D printing and what's additive manufacturing and get lost in the semantics of it all. I don't really. I sort of use the terms interchangeably and don't worry about it too much. But the basics of it is that you make normally relatively low volumes of one-off components directly from a computer-aided description of it, so it's a digital process, and it's nearly always something that builds things up layer by layer. So if you want to make this shape, the first thing you do is decompose it to be that shape. And you make all the layers, stick them together, and you've got your shape back. And that's the bit. So rather than making the thing, you make all of these and consolidate them. And that's what gives it the name. And the first thing to understand about 3D printing is that it's not one thing, it's lots of things. So you, as I said, I had on the previous slide, you have your solid description of whatever it is you want in your computer, you decompose it into a set of layers, you then put it into a machine, which makes all the layers and sticks them together in some way, and what you get out of that is hopefully what you started with. But this machine could be one of the, that's now a day, it's 50, 60, however many, four types of machine, lots of different types of machine, and they can cost from £500 to £500,000. And clearly, what the £500,000 machine does is different from what the £500 machine does, and that often gets lost. And so it is a set of techniques which share these bits, but where this sort of engine that makes it all can be lots and lots of different things. And it's just an idea of what things look like. These are kind of maker type machines, the ones you can buy and make yourself, and then you can print what you want. There's a set of kind of mid-range machines, which cost from about £10,000 to £100,000. At the higher end, there's a set of kind of laser-based machines, and you have to have lasers, and lasers aren't that expensive, but maintaining them is, it starts to get more expensive as well. And they all do kind of different things. I'll illustrate two of these just because they feature in the talk on what I'm going to say later on. This type of machine where you're doing a low cost thing, and this type of machine which is actually based on conventional printing technology that uses it slightly differently. And so the first one, generally known as fused deposition modelling. And what you have is a nozzle. Put polymer filament into it, you melt the filament, and then you extrude polymer at the other end. And then when it comes out, it hardens, and that makes your pot. And you sort of move the nozzle around so that it actually sort of creates the geometry you want. And one of the good things about 3D printing is that it's kind of young enough to be unusual. So this is big. Right, so this is the part that they're going to make. And the video that they show you of making this part is really quick. It's a wine glass, but it's an American thing. So it's a wine glass that is 1 inch tall. So don't think it's an actual scale of wine glass. It wouldn't pass for a wine glass in my house, I think is the main thing about it. But it does just, so that's the object that we're going to make. That's the machine, as I just said. So inside this box is the heated nozzle that you saw. And it squeezes out a bit of polymer. And you get a track, and that's the bottom bit. And then it keeps going. Go back to that. And just adds a number of layers on top. And so it's both a good and a bad thing. Things being on YouTube because sometimes they're in focus, isn't it? So you didn't quite get to see what that was, but I'll go back. It's a somewhat blurry image. It's bigger, right? So that's kind of what's going on. If we go on a little bit, so it just keeps on adding layers to all of that. So you can see you've got the kind of the base here, the stem there, and it's just making the glass bit by adding the layers on and on and on. And it doesn't get any more exciting as a video overall. You can watch the whole thing at your leisure, as they say. But it eventually get round, listeners. This one's called 3D printing, and there's two different types of 3D printing. I'll talk about this one. It's different from the other one because actually you don't print the material itself that you want in the end, you print the thing that binds the material together. So you start off with a bed of powder and spread that powder, and then you use sort of conventional inkjet head, same as you get on your printer that sits on your desk and does paper documents. And it prints droplets on, and where the binder, the printer, the ink, if you like, is the powder, it acts as a glue and it sticks the powder together. And it does that for a full layer, and you drop this down a bit, spread some powder on top, and do the next layer. Just keep on building it up, powder layer by powder layer by powder layer, get through a layer, and then you get the thing. And again, it kind of makes a lot more sense when you see it happening. So this is it's known as the Z-core process. And the Z kind of that always gives it away that it's an American process for loading. So go with that. So there's your print head, same as you buy in staples or whatever. That's the part you're doing, and then that's it printing. So the white stuff here is powder, and that's the powder bed. You can see the colour appearing is one of the layers that's being printed into the thing. The ink, if you like, being deposited into that layer. So you build it up. That's what we're looking for eventually. When you get to the end, you take all the powder that you didn't want away. So that's just been there, and it gets recycled, and you're left with the part that you printed the shape on. That gives you the shape, and then because the toner, the printers are normally not so structurally, or not really structural materials, there tends to be some sort of finishing, so you'll dip it in resin or you'll strengthen it in some way or other, all that kind of stuff. But it's a really, really nice process because there's kind of nearly no moving parts. The moving parts that you do have weigh nothing, so there's no inertia, there's nothing needs to move quick, nothing needs to do anything. It's the single most reliable machine I've ever bought, I think, in a research sense. Given it loads of abuse and it hasn't broken down ever. They're genuinely quite nice things. So that's what they got on those. But like I say, if we wanted to look at videos of every 3D printing process, we'd be here until tomorrow. So I'll just do those ones. And so the features, they say it's rapid. If you watch a 3D printer making something, it doesn't look rapid. And the rapid bit was a tag that came from engineers. Because traditionally, if you have to make things using lots of processes, you have to do lots of planning and thinking about what you need to do. And the rapid bit is actually about the fact that you don't have to do any planning. When you finish your design, you can print it. And that saves a lot of time. The cost is generally about volume, not geometric complexity. So if you have something that fits in the same box, it doesn't really matter if it's a complicated shape or not, or just a block, whatever it happens to be. So put those two together. Cost one, generally, favour low volume, geometrically complex components. It costs the same to manufacture 100 one-offs as it does 100, a batch of 100 of something, as long as they're all the same size. It costs more to design 100 one-offs, but the actual manufacturing of it often does. Lots of material combinations, all the rest of it, but not that many of them are currently commercial off the shelf. And what you can do on one machine, you normally can't translate to another machine. So if you buy a machine, you have a family of materials that go for it. Buy a different machine, you have a different family of materials that go for it. But the key thing is that it's an entirely digital supply chain. So you can scale the bits around it in a different way from how you would conventionally if you didn't have the digital opportunities. Very quick medical application. applications and just some thoughts around that before I get to the sort of bioprinting one. Has anybody heard of Invisalign? No. So they make, but everyone's aware of the kind of metal teeth braces that are very common, particularly in the States, where everybody's obsessed by teeth. But and this is a company that started off in the States, and what they do effectively, they take an impression of your teeth, and then the process is about moving your teeth about so that you get a more beautiful smile. And they design these aligners, which over the process of a week, you wear them and they push your teeth. They constantly put pressure on your tooth to push it into a preferred position, just the same as the metal braces do. And what they do is they take a scan of your tooth, they then digitally, so in a CAD system, move your teeth about to get them to the place where they want them to be, and then they design these based on that, print them and cast from them in order to get the aligner shape that's going to push your tooth exactly where they want it to be. And this has been a huge, huge thing. So it started off in California and Mexico. So California was the design, Mexico was the manufacturer about 15 years ago. They've now made 60 million individual tooth aligners. And actually, last time I went to the dentist in Newcastle, there was a big video on the wall with Invisalign, so it's nearly everywhere now. But that's a sort of, that's proper mass customization. This isn't a craft business anymore. It's a completely digital customization business. The other huge one's been in the hearing aids, and most people have seen so these types of hearing aids around the place, whereas you used to have the bulkier things that had the battery on the outside, that kind of thing, all of which they fit in the ear now. So that's that industry, the shells for those are almost entirely made by 3D printing processes. In this case, it's a process known as cell lithography. So they put a lot of silicon gunk in your ear, and then scan it, and then design around that, and then put the hearing aid engine inside it, and use that around. So that's the thing. And again, for both of those, you go back to the small, complicated shapes, and that tends to be what the business made us for, business models. That's more of that. Surgical guides has been a huge one, dental ones, all kinds of other ones. So this is just something that's shaped to fit on your teeth. It's a little hole, so the dentist knows that the drill is going to go in exactly the right place. Anywhere else? Teeth themselves, or bridges, caps, crowns. Things that you then build up the enamel on top of to make them to fit into your own mouth. Things. And you can make them sort of directly as they are there, so that these are made out of metal powder or and then use the wax to cast for it. And you can get them that way around as well. Again, you can make them out of metal powder. So this is 201 individual crowns sort of made for all of the individuals. So again, it is lots of customization. I also think the tricky bit with this is now making sure that the right thing gets the right person in my view of it. I have this sort of mental image of 201 people queuing up behind this and taking the one at a time, trying it, putting it back, trying the next one. I'm not sure, I'm sure they'll be cleverer than that. slightly bloody one, but different surgical application. This is sort of a jaw reconstruction. Somebody who's had a chunk taken out of their jaw for a cancer tumour. And this is quite an early example, and it's worth noting that the design of this isn't terribly sophisticated, as it were. It is just a lump of solid metal. And the more recent ones tend to show where the technology's gone on a bit. People So now this is rough rather than smooth, because that's better for tissue to attach to. We've got specific areas here for tendons and things to reattach to so that your jaw actually moves, a conventional one would. We've got spaces for things to grow through, and you put the teeth in. And these bigger bit holes are there to reduce the weight. So it weighs the same as your jaw. The other thing you could do is make these kind of come back to a little bit, these quite porous parts where you put together almost a kind of steel mesh in different ways. And this is for a maxillofacial plate. This is commonly made for people who go motorcycling in the wet. That's the surgeons always know that that things are going to come their way when it's raining in the summer. And it's made out of this mesh, and there are good reasons for making it out of the mesh. The first one is weight, again, so that it doesn't weigh so much. Secondly, so that the bone grows into it, natural bone grows into it, through it, and it attaches. And the third one's actually to do, it's just straight away, it's to do with thermal conductivity. If you've got a big metal plate there, then it gets really hot in the summer and really cold in the winter. And it's genuinely, it gives people horrendous headaches. And so having something that takes some of the thermal conductivity out of the system is a good thing in its own right. And you apply the same thing to complicated orthopaedic implants. So this is the front and back of a hip cup being put in around the pelvis. And things for outside of the body as well, foot and ankle foot orthoses. So these are to correct walking behaviour. We work with a company in Newcastle, we're part of this European project. And we also work with a company in Newcastle that supplies these into the NHS to do design. So with the general idea being that you scan the foot, you do some personalised biomechanics, that gives you a design that gets created and given to the patient. So it's a kind of, again, fully digitally integrated system. So then we've gone to a rough definition of biofabrication by printing. It's really about combining cells, proteins, biomaterials, other bioactive elements as building blocks to make biological things. So rather than just being an implant which is there and it's static and it's biocompatible, but it never changes for the rest of its life, something that starts to interact with the body in some sort of meaningful way. Now, 3D printing isn't exclusive to bioprinting or biofabrication, but it is one of the things that gets involved in it. Mostly, as we've seen from the examples we've shown, because that you can make anatomical shapes out of it. And do things that way. So, I'll then go back to where I was going to begin. So practical bioprinting is what I'm going to talk about. But again, it's one of those things where there's a lot of hype about. Just in order to kind of explain the background where I am coming from, and Shin introduced it a bit. So we have the EPSRC Centre for Innovative Manufacturing and Medical Devices, which sounds like it's everything, but actually it's not. The EPSRC insists on us having this title, but actually that centre is solely about Class 3 implantable medical devices. So that's load-bearing musculoskeletal medical devices. So it's very misleading name. This is clearly orthopaedic, maxillofacial, again load-bearing, and part of the Arthritis Research UK Tissue Engineering Centre. And because it's Arthritis Research UK, that's very musculoskeletal as well. And so our starting point, an awful lot of this, and this is sort of where our funding has been for the past 5 years, is very musculoskeletal. And what I'll do, really, is I'll talk through one of the things about practical bioprinting is that you have to have a prospect of doing somebody some good. And in order to do that, you need to understand what the clinical challenge is. And so I'm going to talk through the clinical challenge in terms of osteoarthritis. And then I'll talk about scaffolds and implants, bioprinting, and cell material. So,
osteoarthritis is a yes, it's a horrible disease. It affects lots of people, and it's, if you watch, this is what a joint looks like. See, a ball, socket, perhaps your leg, all the rest of it. This picture is sort of meant to suggest that you have a shiny, lovely layer of cartilage on the outside of that ball. When you get osteoarthritis, then that gets damaged in some way. And eventually, you end up with a bit of a hole. But if you watch this for the moment, the blue is the cartilage. It's a sort of degenerative process. So gradually, the cartilage becomes sort of unpicked, until you get to the stage where there's nothing left but the bone. And you've got bone on bone contact, and that's really painful. The cartilage is there, it brings, doesn't have any nerves in it. Yep. So you get hit on that and it doesn't hurt. Whereas as soon as you've got bone, you've got nerves, you've got pain. And that's where an awful lot of it comes from. And it's one of those things that you can, people will say it's cartilage disease, some people will say it's bone disease. Generally accepted opinion is that it's a disease of the joint, which is, I think it has to be both. But yes, often you not only need to fix the cartilage, you need to fix the underlying bone. Because the bone is where the pain comes from, even if the cartilage is the thing that's missing. So it's a complicated disease. And this is just a huge lesion, as it were. So you shouldn't be able to see that bit in the middle at all. That should all be covered by this white cartilage stuff. And it's a bit extreme. It gives you an idea of the kind of thing we're looking at. It affects lots of people. So by the time you get to the age of about 60, you've got sort of 15% males and more like 25% females will develop osteoarthritis and so forth. The difference is, I don't think anybody's completely nailed down, but part of the chemistry of the disease seems to be hormonal. And it's substantial disability in the elderly, not so elderly, at an individual and societal level. So it effectively stops people going out. And that's the biggest impact it has on people's lives. Because people become isolated and have much more miserable lives. It's a lot. But it's slightly complicated. Because up here, you have what people think of as traditional osteoarthritis that old people get. There's a number of kind of cohorts in the middle where people, it's interesting, you get this type of osteoarthritis where cartilage degenerates and then you get pain and damage. Over here, this can be, you have an accident, your cartilage gets damaged, and that turns into osteoarthritis. So it can go one way and the other way. And back here tends to be things that you're born with, effectively. And so there's lots of ways and means that you can develop osteoarthritis into it. So there's not a single trigger for it. And if you talk to a number of people, they'll tell you that cartilage cannot regenerate. So once you've damaged cartilage, you won't get it back again, it won't regrow. And that's not true. This is a clinical case of a knee, and this is clearly lots and lots of damaged cartilage. And what they did, all they did, this individual, was realign the knee. So just changed the angle of the two bones a bit. And a year later, lovely cartilage. So it can happen, it's just hugely unusual. And so the problem is that we can't make that happen reliably. And we don't seem to be able to engineer it happening in that kind of sense. And the quality of the cartilage is a bit different from what you'd have sorted off. People argue a little bit about whether the quality of the cartilage is the same. But this person is walking, so they don't really care about the argument. You can see the same in mice, partly this sort of suggests that there's a kind of genetic component of the disease. So this flavour of mouse C57, DI6. If you get a cartilage defect, it doesn't heal. That picture. This one, it does. So, and those are two mice exactly the same defect, one heals, one doesn't. All the difference is just in the genetic makeup of the mice. And this is from a study in rabbits where they made a scaffold, introduced some beta, and you see some cartilage like material reappear again. Rabbits aren't always a great model because rabbits appear to be able to heal almost no matter what you do to them. They're very hugely resilient musculoskeletal systems. But broadly, there's quite a lot of evidence that the cartilage can be made to regenerate, but we just don't know how to do it. That's it. So, regenerative medicine then, tissue engineering, I've called this regenerative approaches. It's a slightly long story. So the classical view of tissue engineering was you had somebody who wasn't well, and you had some cells. And you take the cells, you put them in a structure called a scaffold. You then put that whole thing, you might add some proteins, some biomolecules, some growth factor. You put that in a bioreactor in order to turn it into the type of tissue that you wanted, and then you'd implant that into the cells. And kind of 15 years ago, that was the accepted view of tissue engineering. But it kind of turns out to be a bit more complicated, if you like. Clearly, you have to get the cells from somewhere. And a traditional view that you'd have a cell factory. If you had a particular condition, you'd go to the cell factory, get the type of cells you need, take them through that cycle, and you'd be better. In order to do that, you have to have a population of cells that you can guarantee will work in everybody, or in an identified cohort of the population. And that's a genuinely very difficult thing to do, to prove that it will do no harm to anybody who you might identify for that particular treatment. But it is happening for some things. The other approach is to take cells out of the pouch, to start with. So autologous. So, and that's a sort of easier way of doing it to get your head around mentally, also easier for regulators in some ways. Giving you your own cells back doesn't necessarily seem such a bad thing. So that's kind of one level of complication. Then I figured out, well, actually bioreactors are always very good. They would be the base of it. But there's about 30 odd very good bioreactors in this room. Yeah, so the easy thing to do is to take this, don't put it in a bioreactor, put it in the pouch and let the body sort it out. So using the pouch as bioreactor, different approach. A lot of traditional cell therapies don't worry about any of these steps at all. So bone marrow transplant, you get some cells, you get a heterogeneous population of cell plus tissue plus soup plus whatever it happens to be, and you put it into the pouch. And that regenerates the bone marrow. That's something that's been done since the 1960s. And so that works. Interestingly, I've got a view that actually would be very difficult to start doing that now. You can get away with a lot more in the 1960s, is the interview. Further complication, there's what people call minimally manipulated cells. So if you take cells out of the body, you don't do anything to them. You don't expand them, you don't do any particular manipulations on them. Effectively, you just take them out. You might filter out some bits and pieces and put them back in again somewhere else they're needed. That's a different approach, and you can do that either with or without a scaffold. It's with a scaffold that it's no longer minimally manipulated, but the general concept still works. Then, further approach, which is actually to do away with the cells, and to say if we can get a scaffold, and if we can put the right molecules on it to attract the cells that we want to come to the site and do the repair, that's an alternative way of doing things. one is to do everything inside the body. So you reposition the cells within the body. If you have an area of the body that needs repair, and you have some cells that might be able to do it, you simply get them to go to the right place. And I'll show an example of that in a minute. That's the hardest one to get around. And so, from a sort of a traditional, almost a classical view of tissue engineering, you end up with an awful lot of different approaches, an awful lot of different ways of going about things. And so, really, the question, in a practical sense, but what's practical, is really, which of these is going to work in a scalable way? And that's the kind of the genuine question about the first element of bioprinting. So if we just go back to joints then, there's two existing cell-based treatments for joints. One's something called autologous chondrocyte implantation. You clean up the damaged area, you put a patch over the top of it, artificial patch, and then behind it you inject a lot of chondrocytes, cartilage-making cells, which you've made from cartilage that you've harvested 6 weeks before. So you take some cartilage, grow it up, do the operation, inject them behind it, and that's how it works. And that's a process that seems to work around about 80% of the time in a carefully selected population. There's a group in Oswestry, Street, a specialist orthopaedic hospital, and there's another group at UCL doing this. They're the only two places in the UK that are doing it as a procedure at the moment. It's still very young. And that's good. It works. But the main problem, so ACI works, and it's a good process. The main problem is it's not scalable. The 6 weeks, growing up your cells, doing all the rest of it, all that kind of stuff, you can't do it for 30% of the population. The resourcing to do all of that just isn't available. We'd run out of nurses, doctors, surgeons, hospitals before we'd actually got to that number of treatments. And so, that's one way to do it. Microfracture is the other way, which is repositioning the cells in the joint. And what you do is a bit of an agricultural process. Again, you clean up the area, and then you literally hammer a nail through to get to the marrow behind it. You let it bleed out, so that you bring some stem cells and other materials through, and you let that do the healing. Effectively, so that's fairly cool. So clearly, that's just been cleaned, and then they let some stuff come through. And that works to some extent, but not consistently. And it's a bit of an issue around that. And so it's not a sort of microfracture or marrow stimulation, but it's another approach to doing it. It also clearly doesn't work for where you've got a problem with the bone as well as the cartilage. You need the bone to be kind of well enough for you to batter a hole in it, which is only acceptable. So, going on then. So neither of these, if you go and look at the NICE, the guidelines, National Institute of Health and Excellence, neither of these is recommended as a procedure for treating osteoarthritis or any kind of joint problem. In effect, what NICE say, I'm sort of paraphrasing, but if you have early stage osteoarthritis, and if you look like me, go to the doctor, you need to lose weight, take paracetamol, and kind of manage the condition until such time as you're in so much pain that you're ready to have a joint replacement. That's the basic process at the moment. Because none of the other ones is scalable enough or good enough to offer them generally. And so a practical solution is really what we're about in that sense. So, thinking about what are the possible strategies for treating small defects in a joint. And we sort of say you can treat the bone, you can treat the bone and the cartilage, or you can just treat the cartilage, and you can do that with or without cells. Those are the kind of options that are available. And so I'll then go back to printing, having kind of set the scene for that. But the scene's important, because there's lots of bioprinting strategies, lots of things you could do that wouldn't be remotely relevant to that disease. And one of the things about sort of practical bioprinting is about knowing what problem you're trying to solve. So we work on scaffolds. scaffold to cellular devices. We use polymers, ceramics, composites, also biopolymer, bioceramic, biocomposites. We've got kits that we can batch manufacture, so we can make hundreds or thousands of scaffolds in order to get them going. And when we do make and ship thousands of these every year, we do use established processes, we develop our own processes, you see. But for musculoskeletal applications, the focus has been on making what we call robust porous devices. They have to be load bearing and they have to be able to survive the amount of abuse that an orthopaedic surgeon will give them as they're being implanted. They have to be implantable, you know. So we use some biopolymers. This is a sort of model system based on PLA that we use. And this is back to the fused deposition model. And what we do is use it to make these very porous, known as log-pile structures, where we don't fill in all the gaps when we're laying down these lines. So you end up with something that's about 50% space and 50% material. And the idea is you could either seed that cells or proteins or not at all, implant it, PLA as a material will resolve over the course of a number of years. PCL, another material we use, that's roughly the same. They have advantages and disadvantages. But that's kind of the broad process we can use.
Sorry, Kenny, what's PLA?
Polylactic acid. So a natural biopolymer.
Okay, and then that gets reabsorbed.
Yeah. PLA isn't necessarily the best material. It's structurally one of the best. It has tendency, if you have it as bulk polymer, to release quite a lot of ions all at the same time later on, which just causes problems. But it works well in small doses, or as it were, or if you can buffer it as well. And so some strategies along those lines. And just as a sort of example, so this is an in vitro version of that log pile that we use, just to demonstrate that you can, that the space allows you to make the biology happen. So this is one that so it's been seeded with stem cells and in normal media. This is seeded with stem cells in chondrogenic media. After 21 days, the blueness tells us that we're starting to generate proteins associated with collagen. And so we've got gags and that kind of thing happening here. So we can force stem cells to into a sort of cartilage-like lineage. This is from an animal study. So this is one of the but it's from a rather gruesome rat calvarial model. So you chop the disc out of the skull of a rat, put these back in place, and then let the bone grow into it. 2 weeks after surgery, we've got bone growing in and around and through the scaffold. 12 weeks after, we've still got it all there, but the bone's a bit more mature. So as a way of encouraging tissue to get into the structure, the porosity does actually mean something. Yep. So it starts to interact with the natural tissue. A slightly different approach we've been using in some ways. I think this kind of shape is interesting more as almost as a using it almost like a carrier for cells. So this is, and often it's useful to put cells in gels. So this is cell into the dots. You can see your cells. They're in a gel, and that's then loaded inside this thing. And gels are really good at supporting the cells over long time periods. But the trouble is with gels is that they don't always stay where you put them, and the scaffold, like, helps the gel to stay where you actually want it to be. That's the kind of rationale. But that's something worth developing.
So how does blood get into millions of cell structures?
Sorry?
How does blood or how does oxygen get into millions of cell structures?
Let me show you another picture in a minute. So because we wondered about that as well. Vascularization in tissue engineering is the elephant in the room, as it were. This one's bioceramics. using sort of the Z-Corn process we did earlier. What we do is we make our own powder. It's a material called apatite-containing black ceramic, which has a mineral content very close to gold. And we print the thing exactly the same way as you saw in the video, but then we take it away and put it in a furnace, and we heat it up to about 1400 degrees C. That burns away all the polymer, and it consolidates the bits of ceramic together. It's a sintering, is the process, isn't it? And what that gives us is a porous bioceramic. So it's about 50% dense, there or thereabouts, but all interconnected. And so it's a strong